Later, Lamont Lewis was driven down to Delaware, where he tossed the gun that he had off the bridge. What did Robert Merrick get for this? The defendant, Robert Merrick, got a used Oldsmobile for burning down the house and killing the family. Now, how did Kaboni Savage from the Federal Detention Center respond to these murders? Testimony will show, ladies and gentlemen, that he was delighted with these murders, and he planned to commit even more. In fact, you will hear Kaboni Savage in his own words on November 3, 2004. He is talking to a person in the cell next door, a man by the name of Al Shannon Muse. Al Shannon Muse and he are joking about it. Al Shannon Muse says, "Well, by the time of trial, everybody be dead." And Kaboni Savage says, "And we're just getting started. The night is still young." The next day, Kaboni Savage heard that Eugene Coleman was granted a special privilege of being taken out of the federal detention center by agents so that he could attend the funeral of his family members. You're going to hear that Kaboni Savage thought this was unfair because most people don't get to do that. Kaboni Savage complained about this and said, "Well, when the agents take him to the funeral, they should stop off and get him some barbecue sauce and pour it on them burnt bitches." That's what you're going to hear was his reaction from Kaboni Savage after this. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you've heard about the indictment in this case and the charges in this case. You see, in this case, count one, as the judge said, is all four defendants are charged with racketeering conspiracy, conspiracy to participate in the affairs of a racketeering enterprise. You've heard about a pattern of racketeering activity, and that pattern, as set forth in the indictment, as you'll hear, was murder, dealing in drugs, arson, witness tampering, witness retaliation, and money laundering. You're going to hear and see evidence of all of those crimes as part of this racketeering conspiracy. All four defendants are charged with that. They are charged with participating in this racketeering conspiracy at various times from late 1997 to approximately April 21st, 2010. You're going to hear that this racketeering enterprise, you're going to hear an enterprise is simply a group of individuals associated, in fact, a group of individuals who get together for the purpose of committing crimes. You've heard also that conspiracy is simply an agreement to commit crimes. This North Philadelphia-based enterprise, you're going to hear, packaged and distributed controlled substances, including hundreds of kilograms of cocaine, crack cocaine, heroin, PCP, and marijuana. Usually the marijuana was saturated with liquid PCP and something called on the streets wet. The drug revenues you're going to hear were laundered by purchasing houses and cars in fictitious names. Rival drug dealers, suspected informants, and associates whom Savage deemed disloyal to the enterprise were threatened and they were beaten. They were shot and were murdered. When these defendants were investigated and prosecuted, they attempted to thwart law enforcement and the criminal justice system by threatening, intimidating, and murdering witnesses, potential witnesses, and the family members of witnesses. The indictment charges again the conspiracy in count one to participate in the affairs of a racketeering enterprise. There are 12 murders charged in this case. You've heard about six of those already, the murders of the Coleman family on October 9, 2004. As I said, Robert Merritt and Kadita Savage are also charged in those six murders of the Coleman family, all in furtherance of this enterprise charged in this case. Of the other murders, the earliest one occurred in 1998 and the last one in 2004. If you look at counts 2 through 7, the defendant, Kaboni Savage, is charged on March 19, 1998 in count 2 with the murder of Kenneth Lassiter. In count 3, Kaboni Savage is charged with committing the murder and ordering the murder of Mansur Abdullah, also known as Shafiq, on December 6, 2000. In count 4, Kaboni Savage is charged with the September 13, 2001 murder of Carlton Brown, also known as Muhammad. In count 5, Kaboni Savage is charged with the February 26, 2003 murder of Barry Parker. Lamont Lewis was charged in that case. In count 6, Kaboni Savage is charged with the March 14, 2003 murder of Tyrone Tolliver. In count 7, Kaboni Savage and Stephen Northington are charged with the March 1st, 2004 murder of someone who was scheduled to testify as a witness at the Lassiter murder trial, and that was Tobias Flowers, known as Tibby. You see, count nine is a conspiracy to commit murders of the Coleman family. Count nine, you see Kaboni Savage and Robert Merritt are charged in that conspiracy charge and that they conspired, among others as well, with Lamont Lewis to kill the members of the Coleman family. Then you'll see counts 10 through 15, which are the individual murders charged, murders in aid of racketeering. Charged in count 10, the murder of Marcella Coleman. Count 11, the murder of Tamika Nash. Count 12, the murder of Sean Anthony Rodriguez. Count 13, the murder of Taj Portia. Count 14, the murder of Khadijah Nash. Count 15, the murder of Demir Jenkins. Count 16, charges retaliating against a witness. Again, retaliating against Eugene Coleman for being a witness in this case by killing his family. And then, as His Honor told you, count 17, the defendant Robert Merritt, Kaboni Savage, Khadijah Savage are charged with using fire in commission of a felony on October 9, 2004 for those arson murders. You're going to hear especially early on in this trial about the drug organization in this case, a drug organization that eventually was led by the defendant Kaboni Savage. You're going to hear that this organization was in place for a very long time. Previously, it had been headed up by somebody who was a mentor to Kaboni Savage, a friend of his family, somebody he referred to as Uncle Bub, and that person is Gerald Thomas. You're going to hear that Kaboni Savage started selling wet, which is marijuana laced with liquid PCP. He worked his way into cocaine trafficking and eventually dealt in what they referred to as weight, large amounts of cocaine, wholesale amounts that he could sell to other dealers, some of which was kept as powder cocaine, some of which would be cooked into crack cocaine. This organization dealt in wholesale amounts, and they also dealt controlled corners or blocks of North Philadelphia, where the drugs were specifically sold to customers on those corners and blocks by members of Kaboni Savage organization. His Honor mentioned earlier today that the shorthand KSO is, you'll hear that this was not known as KSO on the street. It is simply a shorthand in the indictment, but it is referred to as the Kaboni Savage organization. This organization, you will find, made lots of money. Kaboni Savage invested in real estate. He bought his sister Conchetta a house. He bought his girlfriend Crystal Copeland a Mercedes-Benz. He bought properties and cars in fake names. You'll hear that Kaboni Savage maximized his profits in the drug business by doing something called recompression. He would take kilograms of cocaine, pure kilograms of cocaine from sources. He would then open those kilograms of cocaine, take out some of the cocaine, dilute it by putting in various dilutants and insert substances, and then repackage that cocaine, recompressed it using jack handles, press plates, wood blocks, so that after it was sealed up again, it would look like it came right off the boat. It would look like a kilogram of pure cocaine. Now, of course, diluting the cocaine sometimes resulted in unhappy customers, you will hear. Some of that cocaine really wasn't any good. Some of it couldn't be cooked into crack very well. You're going to hear that this created some difficulties and some hostilities between Kaboni Savage and some of the people he dealt with. Now, as this organization grew, Kaboni Savage emerged as the leader of the organization. He ruled this organization by fear, by intimidation, violence, and murder. He used enforcers to keep other people in line and, when necessary, to murder people who got out of line. Some of those enforcers you're going to hear are Kareem Bluntley, also known as Bree. Another one is Dawood Bey. A third one is Lamont Lewis, whose testimony you're going to hear in this trial, nicknamed Mont and sometimes referred to by Kaboni Savage as Poppy Eye. The fourth enforcer hitman was Stephen Northington. Now, as this organization grew on March 19, 1998, Kaboni Savage would establish himself as the dominant violent drug trafficker in the Hunting Park area of North Philadelphia. He did it by killing an innocent man by the name of Kenneth Lassiter. March 19, 1998, about 4 p.m., Kaboni Savage was on the corner of 8th and Butler Streets in North Philadelphia. A man from Lansdale who had family in the area, Kenneth Lassiter, showed up on the corner. He was visiting relatives and he went to park his car. Kaboni Savage and Kenneth Lassiter tried to park their car in the same spot at the same time, and that resulted in a minor fender bender. Ethan Butler was no usual corner you'll hear. The evidence will show that Ethan Butler was one of the most notorious, one of the most coveted areas of the city of North Philadelphia, and had been for many, many years. At that time, that corner was run by somebody named Tibbius Flowers, and somebody named Ronald Walston, whose nickname was Pumpkin. Tibby Flowers was a boxer, and he was a rival to Kaboni Savage, who was also a boxer. He was a rival drug dealer of sorts. They did not get along. Ronald Walston, Tibby's brother, on the other hand, was a very close friend of Kaboni Savage. In fact, Kaboni Savage, when his house was raided years later, had a picture of himself and Pumpkin on the wall, a memorial, if you will, after Pumpkin was killed. They were very close. So this dispute, which started out over a parking space, in some ways quickly escalated on March 19, 1998, between Kaboni Savage and Kenneth Lassiter. There was a crowd of people around, you'll hear. They talked about Lassiter paying for damage. Savage wanted payment right away. Lassiter couldn't give him payment right away. Kaboni Savage's way of resolving that dispute was to take out a gun, aim it at Kenneth Lassiter, and shoot him in the chest and kill him. Lassiter was taken to Temple Hospital close by, and he died a few hours later of his wounds. The reason for this murder, the evidence will show, was not just over a parking spot. The reason for this murder in front of this crowd and in front of Tibby Flowers himself was to establish Kaboni Savage as a violent drug trafficker in that area, was to establish Kaboni Savage as the head of that area, and was to also shut down Tibby Flowers' corner. Because you will hear, ladies and gentlemen, that when a murder occurs, you're going to hear about another one a little later. When a murder occurs on a corner, the police come out, crime scene tape is put up, and all revenue and drug dealing for that day or even the next day is shut down. You're going to hear that, and the evidence will show that corner was shut down by Kaboni Savage by shooting Kenneth Lassiter in front of Tibby Flowers. Now, as I said, Tibby Flowers was the brother of Ronald Walston, Pumpkin. Pumpkin assured Savage that Flowers would never testify against Savage. That was a concern to Savage because the police came by. When the police showed up at the scene, they tried to interview witnesses, and they took witnesses down to the police station and interviewed them. One of those witnesses was Tibbius Flowers. The police talked to Tibbius Flowers. Tibbius Flowers gave a statement to the police, and in that statement, Tibbius Flowers, you'll hear, implicated Kaboni Savage as the man who shot Kenneth Lassiter on March 19, 1998. A warrant was put out for Kaboni Savage. Savage was nowhere to be found. Savage was arrested later on that warrant for this murder on September 10, 1999, in an apartment that he rented under an assumed name, Joseph Emil in Maple Shade, New Jersey. With him in that apartment, when he was found, was another girlfriend, Jasmine Vidal, and Eugene Coleman. Drug paraphernalia and packaging materials were found in the apartment. Some drugs were found in the apartment, and Savage was taken into custody. Kaboni Savage was eventually released on bail in that case. He was put on house arrest. You're going to hear from time to time he was released on bail, taken back into custody, and you're going to hear at times when he was in jail and out of jail. One of the times when he was out on house arrest, he was at his house, and he was visited by one of the older, established drug dealers in the area, a guy by the name of Bienvenido Morales, whose name was Baby Rock. Baby Rock saw the ankle on Kaboni Savage, the bracelet on Kaboni Savage's ankle, and Baby Rock asked what that was about. Kaboni Savage said, "That's over with. A dumb body I caught. A dumb body I caught," meaning somebody I killed.